appreciate your cynicism and your skepticism. Meet Joe, and it was quite ironic because at the time it was near the winter time, and she said, the nurses kept saying, oh, we're involved in this charity called Backup, and we're actually going skiing with people like yourself next week. So they took, I think, 3 or 4 tetras and 3 or 4 paras to Sweden skiing. And I thought, okay. And they come back and they all came to talk to me and showed me all these pictures and videos of people that were paralysed skiing. Either in a ski car, which I'll show you a picture of, or they were on six skis if they had more of body strength. So straight away I said, okay, sign me up. The doctor said, basically you can't do anything active till at least a year past your injury, till you know your spine's okay, you're physically safe to do something. So he said, give yourself a year. So we planned it and booked it to do a week skiing holiday in Sweden at the start of January 2001, which was pretty much just after a year after my injury. And then, like I say, the plan was to go to Sweden, go do a week skiing, come back and then live independently, as I said. Next slide. So this is how they got me skiing. And just an amazing piece of kit. The idea was, obviously you was hoisted into this bit of kit. As you can see, it's got a low centre of gravity, and it's got a very stable base. The idea was that you steered it with the skis at the front, so if you push both the levers, can you see the levers where the blue bits are, the levers at the side? Can you see them on the picture? Yeah, that's what steered the front of the car. And basically it was kind of the same principles of skiing. If you pulled both levers back, both the skis at the front would go forward, so you'd go faster. If you pushed both in at the same time, it would create like a snowplow effect, so you would slow down. If you pushed one in, then you turn that direction. The idea obviously was to get to ski on your own, build independence and build up confidence so that you could actually participate in outdoor activities. I was very lucky that I got to ski 3 times and I went 3 years on a row. So I was very, very lucky to actually get out and do that. First couple of times, you can see that you had someone behind you kind of acting as an anchor, basically steadying you and acting as a brake. That was okay. But I think it was the third year where they actually said, okay, you know what, you're confident enough now, you've got enough strength now, see ya. And they just let it go. So it's kind of the first real time to me where I felt alive again, and I felt hope again, and I felt independence again, and I was skiing again, and, you know, breathing in the fresh air. And although it was something completely different to what I'd grown up in with skiing and snowboarding, it was still out there in the elements skiing. And it was kind of at this point where I thought, okay, and ski, then what? What else can I do? And I came back in person, and I really did. It was like, right, okay, put the year behind me from the hospital, the injury has happened now, let's put it to one side, I can ski, what next? Next one. So I booked in to do a multi-activity holiday with this company, with a charity called Backup, and they got me out sailing, which was the first time I'd really sailed. I had no control of anything. I had to kind of plop me in a boat, and it was nice to get out of the Lake District and actually go out on the water. Just the feeling of freedom and the confidence, and just to go, okay, well, you know, you can still do these activities, was astonishing. And they got me on a bike, which was like an adapted hand bike, and it was wonderful. You can see it's like a wheelchair frame, and put like handlebars on the front. It felt like being on a bike again. It felt like, you know, I was back on a bike again. I think I managed about 10 metres in about half an hour. the feeling of just being back on a bike again, and going, oh, right, some kind of normality, if you like. It was just a wonderful, it was a wonderful feeling. And then they got me on a wheelchair assault course. As you do. As you do. And this had, it had seesaws, it had balance beams, it had traction mat marks, and I, at the time, obviously, I couldn't really push myself, so, and I couldn't do it in power chair, so it was more a case of, for me, it was just a case of kind of going through the experience, really. But the idea was for people that were strong enough and could push the chairs to actually get over the assault course and go over balance bars and up and down seesaws and jagged terrain and all that kind of stuff. So it was kind of a bit of a realisation. You thought, actually, you know what, you can actually still go out there and have some fun. Okay. So that kind of, also with backup before going to sound, I also managed to, I never got any photos of this, unfortunately, but with backup I also managed to go quad biking. And this was just amazing. I went to Snowden, and they hoisted me. No, actually, lifted me into a quad bike because I've got no grip in the hands whatsoever. So we used gaffer tape my hands to the steering wheel, as you do. But the way that the quad bike had been adapted, it was all done by what's called blown sub technology. So basically, I had a pipe in my mouth, and I think it was if you sucked down the pipe, then the quad bike would accelerate it. And if you put your tongue over the pipe, then you'd keep going at that speed. And then if you blew down the pipe, you decelerate it. So you basically, you know, you've got your steering, you've got your controls, away you go. And this was probably about 2 years after my injury, and I'm like, I can't believe I'm in charge of a quad bike at the base of Snowden. You know, hacking up and down hills, going through rivers, going through trees. And you just think, this isn't... No one told me this. This wasn't expected. And it was just complete freedom. A lot of words you'll hear today, I'll say a lot today, is freedom and independence and control. Left. Can't stop the right, okay. So, as I mentioned about the doing the Community Sports Leader Award, basically I had to do 10 minutes, I had to do 10 voluntary hours to get my placement. I'm still there now. Can we have another picture? So the SAN Club stands for seeing the ability, not the disability. And we're a local sports club. It runs every week, and we work with all kind of people with different kind of abilities, more different age groups. So I thought this was a lovely picture because it shows some of the people, and it shows the whole group really. And this was for the Olympics, and we did like an Olympic based theme. And as I say, I've been involved in this club since 2002. And there's another nice picture of the group. And with the club, we try to do some specific disability sports, but we also try to integrate archery, tai chi, yoga, football, badminton, tennis. We do boccia, curling, and basically any kind of sport that you can imagine. We try and do them and give the kids a chance to do this. In doing so, and I say I've been involved with the club since 2002, and in doing this, it's been fantastic to work with such people, and they see, because if I can do it, and if I can do this, then they can help themselves to deal with their own injuries. And also in doing this, it's kind of pushed my boundaries in this a little bit as well. Okay. It's given me a chance to go caving. And they had adapted chairs, so when I came in the Lake District, which was just wonderful, out in the middle of the Lake District, just went caving. And it also, they forced me down a zip line. I'm a big believer in leading by example, so when it came to Okay, who's going to go first? I'll travel go first. So send me down first. And I found that was great because I could sit at the bottom then and I could go to the kids, you know, it's okay, it's safe, it could take my way, there's no problems. And I felt as though I could encourage them and motivate them from the bottom instead of sitting at the top going, oh, you'll be okay, and I'm going, well, how do we know that? It's like, well, because I've been there myself. And I found it was important for me to actually say, get down to the bottom, and then I could help encourage and motivate them. And I'd say it's a nice little bit of fun for me as well. So that leads me to, once I've been doing the sports for a bit, and I've been the coaching for a bit, I kind of built a bit of confidence, and I kind of pushed a few boundaries aside, pushed a few ghosts aside. And I kind of thought, okay, I think I've got a bit more to offer than just doing sports coaching. So this is where I got into the counselling. And my initial aim was to, you know, try and help people either that are injured or whatever reason, people do go to counselling and kind of help them. But I found it was such a journey for me personally to look at what I'd been through from a theoretical background. And it's when I started understanding about, for example, like, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I thought, yeah, that makes sense, that. And I can really relate to that, all the stuff at the bottom, biological stuff, physiological, and moving up to get to build your self-esteem, and you can't get your self-actualization until you've got everything in place. And for me, doing the degree, it was fantastic to help a few people along the way. But for me, it was a real, real journey of self-discovery, and it really was. And it was a real good chance to look at psychological processes that I've been through without realising, all the grieving processes that I've been through, looking at different theoretical concepts that helped me get to where I am. It was a real, real journey for me. Got a picture. That's just a nice little. It was a fantastic thing for me to go through and actually go through the whole process of the counselling. I feel as though I helped a lot of people throughout the voluntary hours I did. But for me, it was just such a voyage, such a journey of self-discovery, and such a way of. I think I've kind of just wanted to get on with my life and just kind of do things and be active and get out there and do something, but I never really understood what I'd been through, I think. And it wasn't until I got the counselling and I actually went, right, okay, right, so that kind of makes sense. And I can tie this together with this, that, and this kind of process makes sense, and I can kind of relate this to this, that, and the other. And it really made me understand my past, it really made me understand the situation, it really made me accept the situation, and it really made me go, okay, right. I know what I've been through, and I know kind of a bit of a deeper understanding of myself. Okay. So I thought I'd write a book. If you want to know about yourself and you want a journey of self-discovery, write a book. Right. I was so full of self-awareness from doing the counselling, but some things I could kind of reference and some things I could quote back to myself to get the degree. But obviously you're limited in word counts, and I couldn't really express myself how I wanted to. So once I'd got my degree, I thought, okay, I'll sit and write a book. So this is the book cover. And I decided I called it Life Rolls On because I just thought it was appropriate. And it just seemed to me just to be right, just to be the journey from being an AD, from being able-bodied to getting my BA and being a Bachelor of Arts. I just got on with it and did it, and it took me 9 months. And then, because it was quite a niche market, shall we say, a lot of publishers just wouldn't touch it. So I found the route of going down self-publishing, and I published it myself. and Dustin wants a medal. But yeah, it was a fascinating process to sit and write all this up and kind of put it all into context and into make sense of it all and kind of look at the whole journey that I've been through and kind of go through it all really. And next one, I'm kind of in the process of writing a bit more close, a bit more slowly, and a bit more, put a bit more thought into really. One of the things I've always been a fan of, I've always wanted to travel. I travelled, I did the skiing a couple of times, and I travelled a few times with backup. And they all always had the safety net there. They supplied the carers, they supplied you, you made sure the points were available, everything was there, ready for you to go. But because I've been a few times, I wasn't a priority to go again. So it's a case of, okay, I've got to kind of, if I want to go out, I've got to go out on my own. So I did a few holidays where I did like Lanzarote and Gran Canaria, and just did a few nice kind of summer holidays, Badpool, and just sat relaxing. But I need to keep pushing myself, and I need to do more, and I always need to do more, and I always will. So the next picture is, I decided to tell my dad one day I want to go to Egypt. It's not known for its wheelchair accessibility. As you can imagine, so I opted for going in a manual chair and leaving the power chair behind, which was strange because I've come so used to having my independence in my power chair that being pushed around is just awful. This was a health and safety nightmare. This was we was lifted from boat to boat. I had people kind of lifted up the chair up steps. And picking up the arms which come off, and